Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another episode of The World Today, where we discuss the latest headlines from around the world. I'm Ian Mohsin, and I'm joined this afternoon by Mr. Ayoub Mohamed Ayoub, the Foreign Minister for Commercial and a Rotary International Representative. Good afternoon to you, sir.
Good afternoon, Mr. Ayoub.
Let's start off with the World Bulletin that reads that a new Saudi king vows to maintain the predecessor's policies. Saudi Arabia's new king Salman bin Abdulaziz on Friday vowed to uphold the policies of his predecessor. He said that we will carry on with the rightful path set forth by King Abdulaziz Al Saud. Salman added that he said this in the first televised speech as the new king, referring to the first monarch of Saudi Arabia who founded the Saudi state in 1932. Salman, who had been the crown prince of Saudi Arabia, became the new monarch following the death of the king and older half-brother, Abdullah bin Abdulaziz, in the early hours of Friday. We will continue to adopt policies which aim to achieve Arab unity and defending the nation's cause using the teachings of Islam, King Salman said. In a statement carried by the Saudi TV in the early hours of Friday, the royal court announced the death of King Abdullah and declared Salman the new monarch of Saudi Arabia, the world's largest crude exporter. The royal court also named that Prince Mukrim ibn Abdulaziz as new crown prince. Abdullah was recently admitted to hospital and placed on a ventilator after he was diagnosed with pneumonia. Abdullah underwent back surgery in 2012. Ever since, he has refrained from attending events outside the kingdom, including a recent high-profile golf summit held in the Qatari capital of Doha.
First of all, how do you see today's funeral? World leaders from around the world have managed to show up today.
Yes. First of all, my heart and our heartfelt condolences to the royal family in Saudi Arabia, to Saudi people, to the Arab nation, and all Islamic countries around the world in the death of the late King Abdullah. The continuity of the policies of Saudi Arabia is very important. The attendance of the heads of states, Prime Minister of Egypt is there. And we are lucky that we have very good relations with Saudi Arabia almost for a long time now. This traditional relationship with Saudi Arabia, and I can say that the three main forces in the Arab world are Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and Algeria.
Yes.
These are three big powers in the Arab world. Luckily, stability in Saudi Arabia and in Egypt reflects on the Arab countries at large. This is what we are looking for, and luckily Saudi Arabia is continuing its policies, which have been quite tolerant, quite positive and constructive as far as peace process and stability and prosperity in the Middle East is concerned.
And the thing is that Saudi Arabia's policies towards Egypt, especially post-revolution, have been very positive and have helped Egypt pass through this phase quite drastically. How do you see the new leadership? Do you think they're going to continue in supporting Egypt?
It is a matter of priorities and importance. Saudi Arabia leadership knows very well that stability and, most importantly, prosperity of Egypt is to the best advantage of Saudi Arabia in the first place, in the Arab Gulf countries in the second place, in the Arab world in the third place. So I think that we are wise and far-sighted enough to continue supporting Egypt in its new regime, with its new leadership, and its strong leadership, which is heading to better prosperity for Egypt in the years to come.
Also, what we saw today was a swift action from the monarchy itself, getting a king right away into place and then finding a successor, changes in government. Why do you think the movement was so fast in the kingdom?
The smooth transition of power, of rulers in Saudi Arabia is one of the main reasons why it is stable. It does not give any time for the maneuvers by other forces to play inside Saudi Arabia. We are lucky for that, and I'm sure that we will continue the wise leadership of the Islamic world.
And also Iran managed to send out its condolences, even though like Iran and Saudi Arabia have always been enemies to a certain extent.
Iran is looking to its interests. It cannot live in animosity with Saudi Arabia for a long time.
Yes.
And we know for sure that a good source of income for Iran is Saudi Arabia and the Gulf countries. This is number one. Number two, the stability in the world petroleum prices and market is very important to Iran. Mm-hmm. So they cannot live in anonymity and in any bigger situation with Iran, with Saudi Arabia. It is to their own advantage to be at least not belligerent to Saudi Arabia, and it would be better for all of us to deal with more friendship and more cooperation for the stability in our countries, whether it is Iran or Algeria or Sudan or Syria. It is our advantage, all of us, not for a faction, not for any certain faction which wants to make use of these changes in Saudi Arabia.
Well, also, we saw something that was very noticeable, the fact that oil prices jumped right after the king's passing. How do you see this? Is this a sign of future stability, as a sign of hopes that policies towards oil prices will change?
It is a stability, future stability. As we say, Saudi Arabia and Egypt and Algeria, they are three powers.
Yes.
They are a gift to the world, as we say in the rotary. We say, be a gift to the world.
Mm.
That is, be constructive, be beneficial, do the constructive things and the positive things to the others. This is what we do in rotary, and this is what I think that the Middle East is going in this process. Stability of Saudi Arabia is very important to the Middle East, and they are going through a path which is very wise and very stable, and I'm sure that Saudi Arabia new leadership to the continuation of the old leadership, but we just appear his late King Abdullah, God bless his soul, he's passed away, but his brothers and the family know where the interests of the Arab and the Islamic world is.
Okay, let's move on to the next item from our Ahram online. It reads, Davos, Egypt's Sisi invites world leaders to economic summit. The news item itself reads, during the World Economic Forum held in Davos, President Sisi spoke about Egypt's steps towards reform, inviting world leaders and investors to a key economic conference in March. Egypt's President Abdel Fattah Sisi has invited world leaders and investors to an economic summit in March as part of efforts to boost Egypt's economy after the fallout of years of political turmoil. During the World Economic Forum held in Davos, Switzerland on Thursday, the Sisi called on businesses to invest in the well-publicized Suez Canal Logistics Hub, which the country claims will boost its economy. Egypt has also amended the incentives of foreign oil companies operating on its land to encourage further petroleum exploration. Pressure on the less privileged, including by raising prices, will be balanced by new job opportunities and allocating 10% of GDP to education and health by 2020. How do you see Sisi's speech in Davos? There was a standing ovation and applause and so forth.
Where the Economic Forum in Davos, where President Sisi has been to, is a very important platform for the countries to show their plans, their future, and what they need from the other world. Luckily, President Sisi was there.
Yes.
I was quite apprehensive whether or not he would be there. Luckily, he has been there to show what people or what Egypt is today and its plans for the near future and the changes it is making to encourage and give more incentives to foreign investment. As we know, the investment return in Egypt is second highest in the world. We need just to trim and to trim the situation and give the atmosphere of stability, clarity, transparency in the laws, and how do I know the cost before I invest? Any investor coming to Egypt or going to Jabal Ali or wherever they go, they need to know the cost, because we have a big market and big consumed market, I can say, and we have a good labor, we have the water, we have the sun. These are a part of our capital. The labor and the sun and the water and the manpower, this is one of the things which we are selling to the world. President Sisi tactfully portrayed it to the other world and asked them to come and see. And I'm sure that before the economic leaders of the world and the investors come to the world, to Egypt, to Cairo, they will see, we are preparing now a well-planned strategy for other investment, for foreign investment, whether Arab or world investment, to come to Egypt, and we welcome them all the time because it is for their own advantage to invest in Egypt now,
before.
more than any time before.
What about the idea of a unified investment law? That law is coming out very soon. But will that really help an investor if we don't cut red tape and bureaucracy? But this is an issue for a lot of investors, that paperwork and so forth takes quite a long time.
Red tape and bureaucracy are a real hurdle in the face of investors. I remember one of the Egyptian presidents was in Japan.
Yes.
He asked them, why don't you invest in Egypt? The Japanese investment in Egypt is very small to the Japanese investments overseas. Mm. They said to him, sir, or Mr. President, we don't know exactly the cost.
Yes.
If I know the cost, I can say I can invest or not. If I know the cost, I can know how much will I sell.
Yes.
But they don't know the cost. The cost is the other face of the coin of the bureaucracy and red tape.
Yes.
If we cut the red tape and the bureaucracy and streamline it, bureaucracy is not a bad word by itself, but how we use it or how it is used to
direct basically investing.